Ma'am, actually, you're not audible. I think your mic is mute.
पहले मार्क्स तो दे रही हूँ तो
फोटो की कर रहे हैं दिनेश दीपक कह रहा है
तो ईच टीम विल हैव अ मैक्सिमम ऑफ 30 मिनट्स टू प्रेजेंट देयर ओरल सबमिशन इंक्लूडिंग टाइम फॉर रिबटल सेकंड इन मैक्सिमम 5 मिनट कैन बी रिजर्व फॉर द रिबटल व्हिच कैन ओनली बी रिजर्व फॉर एनी वन स्पीकर थर्ड इज टीम आर रिक्वेस्टेड टू मॉडिफाई द डिवीजन ऑफ टाइम बिटवीन द टू स्पीकर एज वेल एज टाइम फॉर द रिबटल एट द बिगनिंग Fourth is no speaker will be permitted to address the court for more than 20 minutes. Team will be intimated. Fifth is team will be intimated on every 20 and 50, 30 minutes. Judges at their and fifth, sixth is judges at their discretion may extend oral argument, extend time up to a maximum of 10 minutes per team. Team will be strictly maintained in monitoring during the complete session as also. While referring to any case laws regarding present law option. Eighth is at the time where one participant is speaking, other are requested to keep their microphones on mute. So these are the rules for the competition. So I request defendant and prosecution to kindly mention their time period in which they will be giving their contention. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
So, teams 519, are you the prosecution, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So let me introduce your honorable judge for this moot court competition. Here is Bhumika Chospa is there. Year of practice is her 10 year experience she holds and majorly in this motor vehicle act, insurance law, matrimonial dispute, labor and industrial dispute, consumer affairs, negotiable instrument act and major panel hold and handling. Delhi Legal Service Authority, National Insurance Company Limited, Oriental Insurance Company Limited, Bajaj Finance, Bajaj Fingera, Shri Murthy Courier Services, and her personal professional achievements are served duty mainly time as the member judge of National Lok Adalat and Lok Adalat as well, member of the Jail Inspection Committee, resource. Person of DLSA by NALSA published many research paper articles on various topics in international and national journals. Guest faculty at University College of Law, Mohanlal Sukhdeo University, Udaipur. So that was our honorable judges for the competition. Now we are waiting for other team and the other judge and then we're going to start it. And everybody are clear with the rules?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, then we wait for the 5 minutes and then we'll let the judges start. Then. Our honorable judge, Mr. Ajit Kumar, has also joined. And let me introduce him to your all. Mr. Ajit Kumar is holding the profession for last 15 years and he mostly practiced in criminal and civil cases. The major panel holded by Mr. Ajit Ji is worked for the visiting and panel advocates, Delhi High Court, Committee, Legal Service Committee, Rajasthan Roadways, Rail Land Development Authorities, DFCCL, and State Bank of India. So each team are requested to tell me how much time they will be taking for their contention. Both the speakers.
From the prosecution side, speaker one will be taking 13 minutes, speaker two 12 minutes, 5 minutes for rebuttals.
Sure. The defense side is there. Am I audible
yes,
to you?
Ma'am.
Okay, so kindly defense side, tell me how much time you will be taking for your contentions for both speaker one and two. Am I there?
Ma'am, I am messaging in the chat box.
No, no, you just speak it out because everybody will get to know that and judges will also get to know.
Ma'am, speaker one will deal with in 10 minutes and speaker two will deal in another 15 minutes. Rebuttal time period 5 minutes.
Okay, now with the permission, with the due permission of court, honorable judges, we are we can start the competition now. You can take the permission from the court now, prosecution side.
Yes, madam, go ahead.
If it please your honorable court, may the counsel for the I am counsel one representing the prosecution. If it please the honorable court, may the counsel refer your lordship as lordship and the ladyship as lordship.
You can refer as a sir, madam.
Yes, you are permitted. Go ahead.
Much obliged, your lordship. May the counsel refer the bench collectively as your lordship.
Yes, go ahead.
Much obliged, your lordship. If it please your honorable lordship, may the counsel move to the statement of facts.
Yes.
Much obliged, your lordship. On the basis of a secret information received to the Delhi police, they searched the general coach of Faraka Express from West Bengal, from Malda in West Bengal to Delhi in the New Delhi railway station, and they arrested two persons and they were found in possession of 5 lakh each of high quality FICN, 2000 rupees notes, 250 notes of 2000 rupees. And on interrogation, it was found that they received the high-quality FICN notes from accused 3. And they also said that this money was going to be used to conduct a bomb blast in the Indian Army convoy on August 15th, 2013. They also revealed that they were supposed to transport 5 lakhs of rupees in Pulwama to accused 4. Accused 4 was searched, but it was found that he was absconding. Later on, it was identified that the person was admitted in a nearby hospital for the reason of poisoning. Later, it was found that he was dead. Then accused 5 was also being searched, but he is still absconding. On the basis of the report from the CFSL CBI, it is revealed that the notes are of high quality FICN. If it please your honorable lordship, may the counsel move to the issue number one.
Yes, word.
Much obliged, your lordship. Issue one is whether the accused person is guilty under section 16, 17, 80, and 20 of the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act of 1967. So the ingredients of section 16 of UAPA is that the person must commit a terrorist act. And the ingredient for section 17 is that the person must provide or collect fund, and also that fund has to be used by a terrorist organization in order to commit a terrorist act. And also the person must have knowledge that this fund is going to be used for a terrorist act. Now coming to section 18, the ingredients is that the person must conspire, attempt to commit or abet, advise or incite the commission of a terrorist act. The person must also have the person must knowingly facilitate the commission of the terrorist act. And the ingredient for section 20 of the UAPA is that the person must be a member of a terrorist organization or gang. Now, section 2K of the UAPA defines what is a terrorist act. And according to it, what is contained in section 15 is what that amounts to a terrorist act. Now, according to section 15, clause 3A, any damage, damage to the monetary stability of India by way of the production or smuggling or circulation of high quality counterfeit Indian paper currency, coin or other material, and also according to clause 4 of section 15, any damage, destruction of any property in India or a foreign country used or intended to be used for the defense of India in connection with any other purpose of the government will amount to a terrorist act. Now from the statement of accused PW witness 1, PW witness 3 and PW witness 4, it is clear that the persons have received high quality FICN and they were trafficking the same. Your lordship, you may please refer to the problem, page 46, exhibit 6, reveals these statements. Now, they also have revealed that this money is going to be used for facilitating a bomb blast to be conducted in the Indian Army convoy. Now, the act that has already been done by them come within the purview of Section 15, and thereby Section 16, 17, 18, and 20 of the UAP are automatically attracted. Now, the activities of the accused persons is not in individual capacity, but they are part of an organized network in order to destabilize the Indian economy and threaten the internal security of the country by raising funds for such terrorist activity. The activity fall within the definition of terrorist act provided in Section 15, and thus they are liable under Section 16 and 18 thereof. The phone calls, the locations of the accused 1, 2, and 3 with the other accused show their involvement in this transportation of fake currency note and the criminal conspiracy. So they are also, okay, now coming to in the case, now the same was held in the case NIA versus Mohammed Anwar Shaq. Now in the case, now the accused persons have conspired to commit a terrorist act, that is to conduct a bomb blast in the Indian Army convoy using the money, that is the high quality FICN. So they have committed the offense under Section 3, Clause A, 3A of Section 15, and also Clause 4 of Section 15. From the analysis of the documentary evidence which was seized during the searches and the statement of the witness and other incriminating evidences, it is clear that the accused 3 had an organization in West Bengal, and this organization was supporting for this terrorist act. Now, if it please your Honorable Lordship, may the Council move to the issue 2. Much obliged, Your Lordship.
You can say through them, what is the role of each one?
Role of each person, sir. Okay. So under the first issue, the first accused one and accused two were the ones who were caught with the high quality FICN. So they were trafficking the money, and accused three has an organization in West Bengal, which is like actually acting against the government. So they were acting against the policies of the government, and this organization has received fund from Pakistan and Bangladesh for facilitating their activities. And now, if your Lordship is pleased, may the Council move to the second issue.
Yes,
much obliged, Your Lordship. Now, the second issue is that whether the person is guilty under Section 489B and 489C of the Indian Penal Code. Now, the essential ingredients of Section 489B is that a person must sell, buy or receive or traffic or use as genuine any forged notes, and the person must have knowledge or must have reason to believe the same was forged notes. Now, the ingredients of Section 489C is that the person must be in possession of forged notes, and he must have knowledge or reason to believe that the same was forged notes, and he must also intend to use the same. Now, according to Section 118 of the Indian Evidence Act, a person is deemed to be a competent witness until he is prevented from understanding or answering the questions put to him due to many reasons like tender years, extreme old age, disease, lunacy, or any kind of the same. But given here that none of the witnesses fall within these exceptions, thus they are competent under Section 118 of the Indian Evidence Act. Also, in Madhusudan Das versus Narayan Bai, the court has held that the witnesses that have no connection with any of the accused are not concerned, who are not concerned with whether the accused is convicted or acquitted. Their evidence cannot be disregarded. Thus, here PW1, PW2, PW4, these three witnesses are not in any way connected to the accused persons, and thus their statements can be taken into consideration.
Tell me one thing.
Yes, Lord.
Initially, the FIR has been registered under which section?
The FIR 164 of CRPC.
Under which section the FIR has been registered?
Initially registered, sir, IPC provisions. Or are you asking what?
Initially, he was arrested.
Yes.
At the railway station. Under yes. Which section the FIR was registered?
489B, 489C, 120B.
How 489B attracted?
489B, they were trafficking high quality FIC. Yeah,
how it is attracted?
By filling all the ingredients.
It was supposed to be attracted only 489C. How the 489B attracted?
they received the same accused one and two received this notes from accused three, and they were transporting the same. So according to the ingredients of 489B, a person who sells, buys or receives can be convicted under the section.
When this fact has come, after registration of FIR or before registration of FIR?
Pardon your lordship, I don't understand the question.
When this fact has come, after registration of FIR or before registration of FIR?
Before registration, they received a secret information and they came to the spot and they found that the information was correct, and later on the FIR was registered and the persons were arrested.
Okay.
Now in Antony versus State of Kerala, the circulation of counterfeit currency notes were found to be affecting the economy, and thus it was held that these offenses cannot be viewed lightly. Now PW1 is the one person who gave the information to the special cell of Delhi police, based on which the police came and arrested the persons. Then according to the statement of accused 1 and 2, they have received high quality FICN from accused 3, and they were transporting the same to accused 4. Thus it's very clear that they received FICN and they were trafficking the same, and this attracted and they were also in possession of the FICN, high quality FICN notes. Now they were working as now coming to the knowledge part, the persons they were carrying it in a bag from Malda in West Bengal to Delhi, and then they were supposed to go to Pulwama. A person without knowing what is inside the bag won't carry it in a train, and also it is said, it is revealed that the persons they received commission. It is provided in page 16, 17.10 para, your lordship. It is provided that they received 10% commission for this for these assignments. So a 10% commission just for transporting a bag from one place to another, this itself signifies that it is some kind of an illegal act, which they themselves cannot do. That's why they need agents. So from this, all this, the statement of the witnesses, and also from the other circumstances, it's clear that section 489B and 489C is attracted. Now, if it please your lordship, may the council move to issue number 3.
Yes, go ahead.
Now, issue number 3 is whether the persons can be convicted under section 121 and 123 of IPC. Now, the essential ingredients of section 121 is that the person must wage war or attempt or abet to wage war, and this waging war must be against the government. Now, section 123 requires that there must be an act or an illegal omission, and this must conceal the act of design, which designed to wage war against the country, and also such by way of such a concealment, they must have facilitated knowingly the waging war against the government. Now, from the statement of PW witness 2, it reveals that accused 3 was part of an organization in West Bengal which is working against the government, and it is also said that they received funds from Bangladesh and Pakistan for the same, and also they were working against the many policies of the government in the pretext that they were protecting the rights of the minorities. But from the circumstance, it's very clear that they had hatred towards the government. And now in the case state of Maharashtra versus Rajendra Shantilal, it was held that the charge of obtaining and circulating fake currency note is nothing short of waging war against the nation from inside, and the economic offences hits at its very root of the economy of this nation. So no leniency is required with respect to such crimes.
Time is over for the case, making your summation.
Pleases the honourable lordship, may the council conclude the arguments and let the
other just conclude.
Much obliged, your lordship.
There's negative marking too, so conclude on time.
May the council council for the prosecution seek permission to begin with the arguments of issue number 4.
Yes.
Much obliged, your lordship. issue number 4, whether the accused person is guilty under section 120B of IPC. It is humbly contended that Samir, Moyu and Kalimama is guilty of committing the offence of criminal conspiracy under section 120B of the Indian Penal Code, and it is to be noted that the essential elements of section 120B are there must be two or more persons and they must have agreed to do an illegal act or that is not a illegal by an illegal means, and such an agreement is designated a criminal conspiracy, and some acts besides the agreement has to be done by one or more parties in pursuance of such an agreement. Here accused number 1, 2 and 3 were found in possession of the fake currency notes when the police were arresting them, and there was no possible explanation is coming from them as to where they have obtained the fake currency notes. So the silence on the part of the accused in such circumstances would by itself be telling the circumstance that weighed against them in the circumstance. So and the, according to this, the prosecution has successfully established the complicity of the accused of the commission of the offences punishable under section 489B C, right, with section 120B of the IPC. If the mere intention of one person to commit a crime is not criminal, why should the agreement of two persons to do it make it criminal? So the only possible reply is that law is fearful of numbers, and that fact of agreeing to offend is regarded as a decisive step as to justify its own criminal sanction. So generally, a conspiracy is hatched in secrecy, so it may be very difficult to adduce direct evidence of the same. So the prosecution will often rely upon the evidence of the acts of the various parties, infer and that they were done about their common intention. So the prosecution will also more often rely upon the circumstantial evidence. And the essential ingredient that the offense of the conspiracy required some kind of physical manifestation agreement. So the express agreement, however, need not be proved. No actual meeting of two persons is necessary, nor it is necessary to prove the actual words of the communication. The evidence as to the transmission of the thoughts sharing the unlawful design may be sufficient. So the conspiracy can be proved by circumstance and other materials. And it is also stated in a case, Kega Singh and others versus state. And it is not necessary that.
How ma'am projector tell the how 201 attracted?
Excuse me, sir.
How 201 IPC attracted in this case? 201 IPC, how it is attracted?
Here 201 IPC attracted because the Kalumama, the accused number 3, he have actually destroyed the evidence from accused number 5's house, because he already knew that accused number 1 and 2 was a part of this conspiracy. So that during the interrogation time, they have actually revealed that accused number 3 and 5 is a part of this conspiracy for their ultimate object. So it is already revealed to the police officers. So he knows that it will point to accused number 3, that is the Kalumama. So from escaping from the punishments, Kalumama has destroyed all the evidences. So that's how section 201 attracted in this.
201 attracted only A3, no?
Sir,
201 attracted only on A3, no? Not for the other also. Is it attracted to all accused A3 Kalumama? Whether 201 attracted to all the accused or only A3?
Only to Kalimama, because he went to accused number 5's house and destroyed all the evidences. The gist of the offense is an agreement to break the law. The parties to such an agreement will be guilty of the criminal conspiracy, though the illegal acts agreed to be done has not been done. So it is an ingredient of the offense that all the parties should agree to do a single illegal act. So it may comprise the commission of a number of acts. So under section 43 of the Indian Penal Code, an act would be illegal if it is an offense or if it is prohibited by law. So, and it is to be noted that all the conspirators must know each and it is not necessary that all the conspirators must know each and every detail of the conspiracy, as long as they are the co-participator of the main object of the conspiracy. There may be so many devices and techniques adopted to achieve their main goal of the conspiracy, and there may be a division of performance in the chain of action with one object to achieve the real end, of which every collaborator must be aware, and in which one of them in each and everyone will be interested. And for an offense under section 120 BIPC, the prosecution need not necessarily prove that the perpetrators expressly agreed to do or caused to be done the illegal act. The agreement may be proved by necessary implication. And it is also mentioned in a case Mohammed Usman Mohammed Hussein Minar versus State of Maharashtra. And it is not necessary that all the accused persons should have participated in a particular meeting, and the conspiracy can be provided by circumstantial evidences. And where the trustworthy evidence establishing all the links of their circumstantial evidence is available, the confession of the co-accused as to conspiracy, even without a corroborative evidence, can be taken into consideration. And in the electronic evidence is admissible under section 7 and 8 of the Evidence Act. And here in the moot problems 17.33 and 17.36 and 37 of gives the facts with relating to the electronic evidences, the frequent communication, the call details of the accused persons.
In annexure 1, one bill receipt of electricity connection was sealed in an envelope with the seal of SP. What is your opinion on it? Annexure 1, A3, Kalu Mama. The documents and electronic devices, seizer report of. Sorry, annexure L.
All the evidences are admissible under section 7 and 8 of the Indian Evidence Act, my lordship.
No, that is not my question. My question is, one bill receipt of electricity connection was sealed in an envelope with the seal of SP. That was that is mentioned in seizure of documents and electronic devices from Kalu Urf Mama. So what is the relevancy or any statement or your opinion on this particular electricity connection?
Ma'am, my lordship, I actually didn't get the question.
Annexure L, do you have that? Okay. First, second, third, fourth, fifth. The fifth column of this annexure, sixth, one bill receipt of electricity connection was sealed in an envelope with the seal of SP. That is the mention in seizure of documents and electronic devices report.
Ma'am, my lordship, all that evidence is actually admissible.
How it is admissible?
What
is the relevancy? Actually, my question is, what is the relevancy of this electric connection?
All the electronic evidences, are admissible under section 65A and 65B of the Indian Evidence Act, and already under the moot problem. 2122 and 2323 have already given the technical evidences as to their as to the electronic evidences as to show they are admissible.
Madam prosecutor, you are going to the different way.
Yes, I am talking about the document.
My sister judge is asking regarding the seizure memo at annexure L. That is electricity bill. Electricity purpose of electricity. This is not electronic document. That can be proof of the proof the address, proof of the something else. That you are using the your electricity when you are consuming, you are deciding there.
It is actually,
what is the relevance in this case? She just want to ask.
It is the identity of proof.
What is the relevance? That is the relevance for, you can say that is for the address proof.
It is actually the identity, establish the identity of the person.
Electricity bill can have the identity. Electricity bill can identify your place of residence.
It can actually identify the place residence, so that actually reveals the person's identity.
Okay.
Your time is over.
May the prosecution move on to the next arguments, issue number 5.
Concluding very short.
Issue number 5, whether the accused person is guilty under section 201 of the IPC, it is humbly contended that Kalumama, accused number 3, is guilty of committing the offence of causing disappearance of the offence as he has entered the house of the accused 5, and it is to be noted that the essential elements of section 201 are as follows. The person must know or have a reason to believe that the commission of an offence. The person must cause the disappearance of any evidence of that offence or provide any information which he knows or believes it to be true. So this must be done to screen each offender from the legal punishment. So during the investigation, it was found that the evidence in the house of the accused number 5 was destroyed by accused number 3, as no incriminating evidence was recovered from the house of accused number 3. And accused number 3 had a knowledge that 1 and 2 has committed the offense of counterfeiting currency and criminal conspiracy. The fake notes were also supplied to accused number 1 and 2 by accused number 3. If the lordship is satisfied with the arguments of issue number 4 and 5, the council seeks permission to move on to the prior. Much obliged, lordship. Therefore, in the light of the issues raised and arguments advanced and authority cited, may this honorable court be pleased to convict Samir, Monu and Kalimama for committing the offenses of using as genuine forged or counterfeit currency notes or bank notes, possession of the same under section 489B and 489C, and waging or attempting to wage war or abetting waging war against government of India under section 121, and concealing with the intent to facilitate design to wage war under section 123, and criminal conspiracy under section 120B, the disappearance of the evidence of the offense under section 201 of the Indian Penal Code 1860, and the offense of the Terrorist Act under section 16, punishment for raising funds for the Terrorist Act under section 17, and punishment for the conspiracy under section 18, and punishment for being a member of the terrorist gang or organization under section 20 of the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act 1967, declare the highest possible punishment as prescribed by law under 489B, 489C, 121, 123, 120B, and 201 of the Indian Penal Code 1860, and under section 16, 17, 18, and 20 under Unlawful Activities Prevention Act 1967, and or pass any order it may deem fit in the interest of justice, equity, good conscience, and all of which is most humbly and respectfully submitted. If your lordship is satisfied with the arguments of issue number 4 and 5, then the council would like to conclude the arguments on the behalf of the state.
Yes, word.
Much obliged, your lordship.
Yes, do you want to say something? Yes.
No, lordship.
Okay. Defense, no.
Warm greetings, your lordship. The counsel would like to begin by discussing the facts of the case, your lordship. The two accused, Samir and Monu, who were members of an organization in a small village that works for the social welfare.
Once the facts that we already explained, don't go by the prosecution story, go by your facts.
All right, sir. Should I directly go to the issue?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Indeed, your lordship. As the lordship is well versed with the facts, the council would like to seek permission to the raise issue number one.
Yes.
Much obliged, your lordship. The issue first is regarding the offense of criminal conspiracy for the possession and using of fake Indian currency notes. The council humbly submitted that all accused, that is Sameer, Monu and Kalu Mama, are not liable under section 120B, 489B and 489C of Indian Penal Code 1860. The first sub-issue is regarding the offence of criminal conspiracy under section 120B of IPC. It is humbly submitted that all accused, that is Sameer, Monu, Kalu Mama, are not guilty for the offence of criminal conspiracy. The council would like to refer the case of R. Venkata Krishna versus Central Bureau of Investigation, CBI, which you may also refer the para 2 of page 12 in the memorial. I would like to refer the researcher that he should present the case in the companion. First. It is the case of the bench S.B. Sina and Sirek Joseph, the case of Harshad Mehta. It states that the criminal conspiracy is an independent offense and becomes complete as soon as there is a meeting of minds and unity of purpose among the accused. However, if a person is merely generating an intention regarding the committing an illegal act, will not be held guilty. Now, the council would like to refer to the statements of Sameer in Exhibit 7, where he stated clearly that this is his first job, was to figure out that those people who in the institution may help him out in the successful conduction of the project, where he met Kalu Mama, who was introduced by Iqbal Khan. It is clearly of the fact that there is a Iqbal Khan who is priorly connected to the Kalu Mama. Hence, all accused become part of an organization which works for societal development and to bring the oppressed communities on the par with the rest of the society. As such, for the liability of criminal conspiracy, the essential agreements must have to be fulfilled. However, there is no existence by illegal means that brought the offense of criminal conspiracy. Regarding the second essential ingredient of criminal conspiracy, that there has to be an ingredient agreement to commit an illegal act by meeting of minds. Yes, agreement has done between Monu, Sameer and Kalu Mama for carrying the bags from Malda town to Pulwama. But in reference to the statement made by Sameer and Monu in Exhibit 7, they knew that bags are of money but never knew that the bags are full in heavy amount of fake Indian currency notes. Hence, they never agreed to commit the illegal act under the agreement. The second and third issue. The second and third sub-issue is regarding using and possession of fake Indian currency notes under section 489B and 489C respectively of Indian Penal Code 1860.
Yes, under go ahead. Yes, continue.
Under both sections, the main essential ingredient that applies is knowledge or having reason to believe the same to be forged or counterfeit. The council would like to take reference from the statements of accused one and accused two, where both accused says that they have no knowledge or having reason to believe that the bags they were carrying contain high quality fake Indian currency notes. Hence, the essential postulate of crime under the legal maxim actus non facitium nisi mens citria, that is mens rea, meaning guilty mind of Sameer and Monu doesn't exist while committing the illegal activity of possession of fake Indian currency notes. Neither they have intention nor believe to use fake Indian currency notes as genuine. Hence, the counsel humbly submits that accused are not liable under section 120B, 489B and 489C of Indian Penal Code 1860.
Tell me one thing. Are you admitting that heavy amount of notes has been recovered from your possession?
Indeed, your lordship.
Yes, you are admitting. Then you are also admitting that from where you have taken the money?
Indeed, your lordship.
Then currency is fake. Why 489C is not attracted against you? Forget about any other section.
Section 489B, 489C, there is an...
Especially say that 489C, why can't attract against you? Or 489C?
Sir, it talks about the knowledge or having reason to believe. And they knew that the currency note, they have the currency notes in the bag, but they never knew that it is a fake Indian currency notes. When the report, preliminary report came from the CFSL, then they knew that the currency was of high quality. As such, when there is an informant, Guddu Singh, who informed the police that the two persons who are traveling from Malda town or any small village from Delhi, and on 25th Feb 2015, they reached the platform number 5 and you have to raid, and they kept the possession of fake Indian currency notes.
Suppose you are traveling with arms. You are having the knowledge that I am traveling with arms. You should know the consideration whether arms is legal or illegal. You will have to know the facts. You cannot say ignorance of law is not defense. How 489C is not retracted against you? Can you read the 489C?
Sir, the all accused are working in an organization who also works for the raising funds. That means the collecting the currency notes. As such, they have the intention that they are traveling from one place to another just for raising funds and collect have to transfer that currency notes from one place to another. They never knew that that currency notes that they are kept in the bag are fake Indian currency notes.
Right, sir. Can you explain the reason to carry out the currency notes, even it is fake or real? I'm not going on that, but what was the reason to carry out?
Ma'am, on the basis of, in the reference to the statements of accused one and accused two, they have, the Kalu Mama have given a project to them for transferring the currency notes in a bag from one place to another, that is from Malda town to Pulwama. They have only that work or have to do that activity. Neither they knew the intention, nor they knew that fake Indian currency notes were kept in the bag. As such, Kalu Mama said that the Peter will handle after the Pulwama.
And that money can be transferred to the internet banking also, other modes also. Why it is in cash and you are getting 10% commission for that? You are gaining 10%, and that is a huge amount, only for the handing over to someone else. You will have to be cautious for that. You cannot escape the liability of the 489C.
In reference to the 10% deal, I want to mention a section that is 25 of Indian Evidence Act 1872, which talks about that. Which talks about that no confession made to a police officer shall be proved or against a person accused of any offense. As such, there is no proof that that Sameer or Monu have admitted that they are taking the 10% deal or as a commission.
Yes, go ahead.
Now I want to Now the co-counsel will represent the other issues.
Yes, you may.
Warm greetings, Sir Lordship. The council would seek permission to proceed further with issue 2 and 3. Issue number.
Go ahead.
Much obliged, Your Lordship. Issue number 2 is asked that whether the accused are liable for waging war against the government under Section 121 or Section 123 of Indian Penal Code 1860 or not. Your Lordship, the council would humbly like to submit that the accused A1, A2, A3, and A4 are not liable under Section 120 and 121 of IPC against the government. As the main ingredients of the Section 121 of IPC says that whoever wages war against the government of India or attempts to wage war against the government shall be punished with death, imprisonment of life, and shall be liable for fine. But in the present case, it is pertinent to mention that there is no supporting or corroborating evidence which determines the act as examined in the statement, which just satisfies the condition of waging war, which has been defined in Section 121. Therefore, the Council humbly submits that the investigation conducted by the investigating authority is not satisfactory for the proof of allegations on the accused. For this, the Council would like to refer the case of Mangal Lal Radhakrishnan versus the Emperor, in which the Bombay High Court held that the object of gathering must be qui amino to attain by force and violence an object of a general public nature, thereby striking directly against the king's authority. It is evident of the fact that accused 1 and 2 were not posing harm or threat or any signs of violence, which proves that intention of A1 and A2 was to attain the authority of Government of India. Set aside the knowledge which prosecution is imposing. In furtherance of fact, it is also clear that the knowledge on the part of accused 1 and 2 is missing. Therefore, they won't be held liable for the offense. Furthermore, it couldn't be specifically mentioned or clear by the investigation of both the agencies, Delhi Police Cell and National Investigation Agency, that there is any continuity or any connection between accused 1, 2 and 3, which proves that the essential condition of meeting of minds to prove criminal conspiracy is missing, which has been held in the case of Yashpal Mittal versus State of Punjab, which clears the concept of criminal conspiracy, which is that there has to be notion or permitting between the conspirators. It is nowhere mentioned or stated by the investigating agency that confirms that all the three accused are on the same page, which is that the money which was given to accused 1 and 2 is fake Indian currency notes. Hence, the subject matter of the meeting is fluctuating and there is no sort of iota which evidently proves and confirms the charges imposed by the prosecutions. Further, statement given by DW3 states that Kalu Mama has stated that I, the union leader of organization working for upliftment of oppressed people of West Bengal, the organization was going through a turbulent phase where the government has used stringent policies to put sanctions upon the working of organization. Soon we realized that the sanction was a result of propaganda started by the government to divide the youths on religion and caste and give effect to their double standard policies. This statement given by Kalu Mama shows that the respondent with their team of four more were working on the upliftment of oppressed people in the state of West Bengal against the government, as the government was spreading propaganda in West Bengal to create hatred amongst the youth. Frustrated by the idea of division and hatred by the government, the organization tightened their work with the help of people of West Bengal, where the idea of organization was supported by foreign nations like Pakistan and Bangladesh. Furthermore, the statement given by DW3 as perhaps such attentions and coverage received by the organization working for the oppressed communities were not being appreciated by the government. As contradictory, the government imposed this sanction on them. The government also showed signs of disinterest by imposing sanctions, as the government is against the organization led by accused 3. And the government, by the way of compulsion, wanted to clarify that no one is exposed to their idea of hatred and deep void. Furthermore, the accused is also not liable.
Listen one thing, go through the clause 17.16, call detailed records. Have you gone? Accused A1, A2 both were in constant in touch with A3, A4. And A3 was in constant touch with A5. Have you seen the cell chart?
Yes, sir, lot, sir.
And A5 was giving a command, secret code. दुल्हन को सजाने का वक्त आ गया है. What does it implicate?
Sir, the connection was because of they were working for the organization. It doesn't seem like they were working as a terrorist. They were thinking of committing a terrorist activity. As under section 161 of CRPC, it clearly mentions that the evidence are not admissible. The police evidences are not admissible.
Call record is not a police evidence, that is a electronic evidence. Call record and messages are the electronic evidence. That is scientifically proved.
PW4, Rupinder Singh, Superintendent of Police, in his statement, the call detail records was especially mentioned in his statements.
Council 6, pardon, sir.
That we were referring about your cell chart call record. You were in constant touch with A4, A5. A5 is not arrested. A4 is dead. He has been not arrested. But he was giving you secret message and command also.
Sir, they were getting commands of organizational activity, but not of any unlawful activity. The council would humbly submit that the accused are not liable under section 123 of IPC for concealing or design of waging war. As in the statement of DW2, it was said that when he was 12 years old and when he started going with the father to the small farm, he stayed there whole day and returned home in the evening. Then one day his father introduced a guy named Samir. They became good friends and they were working. They started to doing some work. Samir got the work as a driver, as a businessman, whereas Monu directs to believe that the financial conditions and Samir were not so great that they can barely make their ends meet. After meeting Kalu Mama, they were assigned a task to deliver the bag from one place to another and hand it over to Peter. They knew about the destination and the departing location when they got the ticket and the bag, which was to be delivered, but they were unaware of the fact that they were carrying FICNs. The statement of DW3 is to be examined clearly, where it is stated that I and Monu did not know that in the bag we are carrying fake currency notes. And the basis of section 123 is questioned here, as it is essential that the accused has prior knowledge of design that is being used to conceal the war. Hence, the council humbly submits that the accused are not liable under section 123-121 of the IPC. If your honor is pleased, the council would like to proceed to issue 3.
Yes, go ahead.
That whether the accused are, issue number 3 is as that whether the accused are liable for involvement in terrorist act under section 16, 17, 18, 20 of the Unlawful Activity Prevention Act or not. The council would humbly submit that the accused are not guilty of any terrorist activity, as their statement of witness can't be relied upon, as it has been absolutely no evidence to prove the commission of an act. If they had been planning a terrorist activity, they would have shown their mens rea and they would have their previous criminal records, or they would further lead to the supposition of fabrication of facts by the state. Furthermore, there was no harm to general public during the course. The credibility of solitary testimony of the witness becomes less when it isn't supported by a proper evidence and in certain circumstances. The accused is entitled to benefit of doubt, as there is no other evidence to corroborate the statements of the prosecutors.
Okay.
Furthermore, whether the accused is liable under Section 17 for convicting under raising funds for the Terrorist Act. As Your Honor, we can refer the statement of PW2, which has been mentioned in Exhibit 6, that the firm dedication of the organization was to work for the upliftment of socially backward and oppressed people, which has always inspired them, whereas Samir was looking for some passionate volunteers who helped them in raising funds and sensitizing people against the malpractices of the government towards the oppressed society. The main reason for suspicion arose after the assembly was declared unlawful. And the lodging of FIR, the fundamental monetary support broke out and the organization was not able to raise fund afterwards. The organization started receiving funds from Pakistan and Bangladesh in their mission of uplifting the oppressed class, but the government took the organization as a threat to their policies and they imposed the sanction on their organization. This shows that the accused were not raising funds or smuggling illegally, as the organization they were working for a derived section of society. Furthermore, in criminal proceeding, we have to consider the fact that a person accused is of good character is also relevant, which has been mentioned in Section 53 of Indian Evidence Act. Hence, according to this section, it is established that the accused are of good character and are not having any criminal records. Furthermore, the counsel would like to refer the case of Jigbansu Paul versus State of NIA, in which it was stated that the appeal shall stand disposed of, and since it is established that the accused are of a good character and are not having any criminal record, he must be given the benefit of doubt. Furthermore, that the accused, it is humbly submitted that the accused are also not liable under Section 18, which is charges in offences relating to conspiracies. As per Section 17, as per Clause 17.36, which mentions the technical evidence, which says that the technical evidence in the form of call detail analysis of the mobile phones belonging to the accused person has been collected. The content of mobile phones seized from accused person shows the number of accused persons stored in their phone books, thereby establishing their association. The Counsel for Defense admits it. Furthermore, the tower locations of mobile and their call records and transcript of important established their plans that they were in connection, but not for planning that they were planning for any terrorist conspiracy. The technical evidence doesn't clearly prove any submission, as they were having any plan to blast. Having the contact number on phone book of member organization does not provide any evidence for planning for conspiracy. That if the connections and funds are being collected by Pakistan, it doesn't simply means that they are being used for criminal conspiracy against the nation and carrying terrorist activity. Furthermore, the case of Ravi Sharma versus State of Jharkhand has been cited, which says that it is apparent that the investigation of case under Section 18 and 20 of the Act had to be carried out by a police officer, not below the rank of Deputy Superintendent of Police or a police officer of equivalent rank, whereas the investigation in the present case has been done by a sub-inspector of police, which is absolutely legal, illegal and prohibited by the law. Further, the last sub-issue is that the accused shall not be convicted for supposedly being a member of terrorist gang under Section 20. It is humbly submitted that the accused shall not be convicted under Section 20, as their statement of DW3 submits that the organization was working for the upliftment of suppressed people of the West Bengal. But the government, according to its sanction, sorry for the disturbance, sir.
It's okay, continue.
Sorry. The organization was working for the upliftment of suppressed people of West Bengal, but the government put sanction upon the working of organization, as it was the result of government propaganda to divide the youth on the basis of caste and religion. The process of sensitizing people would have been only possible if they would have better connection among the people. The same statement was given by PW3 that they were working for the betterment of oppressed class of people by making groups and raising funds. The organization started sensitizing people against the double standard policies of the government, and once the sensitization drive was completed, the team was declared unlawful assembly and the FIR was lodged on the people working for the organization. After which, the council would humbly submit that the that the gang should not be convicted for the term as a terrorist gang under Section 20 of the UAPA Act.
Conclude yourself, your time is going to end.
Sure.
Continue with the permission of the respected judges. The respected judges have their discretion.
Conclude it.
The counsel for defense should humbly say that the accused should not be convicted under that the submission done by the prosecution is not valid or not is corroborating or supporting the evidences, as the accused should not be liable for any criminal conspiracy or a waging war against the government. Furthermore, the accused should not be liable for involvement in a terrorist act under Section 16, 17, 18, 20 of the Unlawful Activities Act. The counsel.
Any rebuttal, prosecution?
Yes, Your Lordship. Mm-hmm. May it please the Lordship, may the counsel for the petitioner move on to the rebuttals.
Your main accused, A5, has not been arrested. A4 is dead.
Yes, Your Lordship. A4 is dead. A5 is still absconding.
Absconding. And how all the allegations liable upon A1 and A2?
A1 and A2 has link with A3. It's actually A3 having link with A5. They received, A1 and A2, they have received the notes from A3. And A3 was also part, A3, A1 and A2, they were all part of the conspiracy. And also thereby committing the terrorist act and be liable for under all the sections provided in the IPC and also the UAPA. Now, if your Lordship is satisfied, may the counsel move to the rebuttals.
Yes, go ahead.
Much obliged, Your Lordship. On page 13 of the memorial of the defense side, it is provided that the organization of Kalumama is working for social welfare of the people. But according to the statement of PW Witness 2 in page number 47 in the facts, it clearly shows that they had hatred towards the government, because it is said in the statement that provided that India is PW2 has stated that Kalumama has said that India not being a country worth living and a country of intolerance. All this shows that they have hatred towards the government, and thus their organization is not working for the social welfare. Now on page 14 of the memorial of the defense, it is provided that a statement is provided as the statement of PW Witness 2, but it is not the statement of PW Witness 2, and thus from where that statement has come into being is in question. It is contended by the learned counsel for the defense that there is no sufficient reason to believe that they were carrying FICM note. Receiving 10% commission just for carrying a bag in a train, that too in a train, itself shows that they know that this was something, some kind of illegal thing. And also they were supposed to hand over 5 lakh rupees to Peter in Pulwama. From all this, it's evident that they knew it, that the notes were fake notes. And the Learned Counsel for the defense has not raised any objection against the conviction of accused 3, Kalumama, under section 201. It is not even mentioned in the prayer also. It's not mentioned in the prayer as well. Now, they have provided in page 28 of their memorial that there was absence of force in order to constitute waging war. Now, in the case State of Maharashtra versus Rajendra Shantilal, the court has held that the charge of obtaining and circulating fake currency is nothing short of waging war against the nation from inside, and this economic offense hits at the very root of the economy of this nation, and no leniency need to be shown to such offenses. So from this, it's clear that there is no essential that the person must commit, there must be some kind of force or some kind of destruction caused to the people. And also, according to Section 15 clause 3A, it is said that to constitute a terrorist act, it is sufficient that the person must circulate fake currency notes. Now, in page 18, they have talked about the role of government and in that itself, they show that this organization has got some kind of hatred and frustration towards the government. And thus, insertion is clearly proven from their own state, from the statements provided in their memorial. And in page 17 and 18 of the facts, 17.14 and 17.14 and 17.15, it's clear that they had hatred towards the government. Now, it was contended by the Learned Counsel for the Defense that under Section 25 of the Indian Evidence Act, a confession made before the police officer is no confession. But according to Section 27 of the Indian Evidence Act, if any confession made to the police officer has led to discovering any other facts relating to the fact and issue, then that is admissible. From the statements of accused number one and accused number two is what accused number three was arrested, and all other evidences, their phone locations, everything was tapped, and which formed the continuous chains of events that established the criminal conspiracy. Now, in the prior, as mentioned before, in the prior of the defense, it is not nothing is mentioned about Section 201, and also simply Section 16, 17 and 18 is mentioned, and it is not provided under which act they are pleading that the persons must be acquitted. If your honorable lordship is convinced, the counsel concludes the rebuttal session on part of the prosecution.
Yes, concluded.
Much obliged, your lordship. The prosecution would like to conclude by saying that the persons are guilty under Section 16, 17, 18 and 20 of the UAPA, and also under Section 489B, 489C, 121, 123 and also 201 under the Indian Penal Code. Thank you.
From defense side, who is going to put the rebuttal?
The counsel will do rebuttal, your lordship.
Yes.
With as the counsel of the prosecution said regarding the Section 27 and Section 25, as such, Section 27 is the exception of Section 25 of Indian Evidence Act, but Section 27 uses only for the discovery of the new facts. It's not as admissible as a evidence. And regarding, and I the counsel would like to refer Article 20, Clause 3 of Constitution of India, 1949, that no person accused of any offence shall be compelled to be a witness against himself. Thus, it means that no man is bound to accuse himself. This clause gives protection only if the following ingredients are present. That is, it is a protection available to a person accused of an offence. It is a protection against compulsion to be a witness against oneself, and it is a protection against such compulsion as resulting in his given evidence against himself. So, your lordship, in reference to the organization works with Pakistan and Bangladesh, the council would like to refer by an illustration that nowadays mostly every politician, activist or Bollywood stars have the connection with Pakistan and Bangladesh citizens, or having number of them in their cell phones. But the council would like to take reference from an illustration, that is one of the politician named Mr. Navjot Singh Sidhu, who has good relations with Pak nationals, who has also been seen many times on the news.
Accused were politician or businessman or what you said about the cricketer or any player, who were they?
The council seeks pardon.
as you
madam,
have
madam accused accused not his profile you cannot go to the profile he may be having any profile
yes sir indeed your lordship and in reference to the section 201 of Indian Penal Code 1860 it clearly regarding disappearance of evidence the prosecution counsel said that the Kalu Mama has destroyed the evidence in the house of Sohail but I the counsel referred by counsel want to refer by an illustration that if a person named A is an innocent then how the evidences can be found against them against him as such Kalu Mama is a innocent person and as such and Sohail is also an innocent person says that no evidences has found against him or in his house and in reference to the statements of Iqbal Singh and accused 1 accused 2 and accused 3 they were a proper organization who are working against the malpractices of the government as such I want to refer one more illustration that is there are many children organizations I want to also refer one organization that is Kailash Satyarthi Children Foundation Mr. Kailash Satyarthi in my last meeting with him he said that I work for children rights but I there were many conflicts with the government under him like he is fighting against the malpractices of the or the child he is facing the problems as such the problems always creates when you are work when you are working for the social welfare
throughout your submission there are admitted facts that alleged fake currency has been recovered from you suppose I have purchased a mobile phone from my friend and he has theft that mobile can I be prosecuted and for double or not I may not be thief but I have caught in the possession of the stolen article at least we should fear that I am admitting the so much of crime I have not committed so much crime
so the postulate of crime that is mens rea it is very important while doing an illegal act if there is no existence of a mens rea then it will not be considered as an offense or a illegal act as in reference to the Veera Swami Shanmugan versus state of Andhra Pradesh the accused presented a fake 100 Indian currency notes to the booking clerk for purchasing a railway ticket held the accused had neither the knowledge that the currency note was counterfeit nor did he intended to make it used for a wrongful gain therefore his conviction was liable to be set aside as such it can be clearly seen that there is no existence of a mens rea
you have not caught by the using of the article you have caught by it in the possession of the article if you use then is it given knowledge that I have not knowledge that if 5 lakhs was the fake currency that citation is different for the other purpose and this is a huge amount 100 rupees 200 rupees 300 that is small amount that is in the circulation of the even purchasing article we got the some time fake currency we were not aware that how the 500 notes is coming in my pocket but if you are using the you have not used the you are just transporting one currency to one place to other place and you are getting the commission being as a defense counsel you should be very honest I'm being at the prosecution you are very honest only this liability occurred to me forget about the other that is only for 7 years punishment for 89c you may be the liens for that you may be undergone rest of the section on applicable you should this case was the drawback for the defense good for the prosecution particularly this case you made for the prosecution side prosecution they are an advantageous position but as a defense counsel I will have to admit that I have committed so much of crime that I was not aware of facts Only 489C applicable to me. Why should I prosecute on 489B? Why should I go for the life imprisonment? That is the 489C is lesser punishment. Arrest is okay. That is the best of luck for all of you.
Much obliged, Your Lordship. The council would like to conclude that the all accused, that is Sameer, Monu and Kalu Mama, are not liable under section 489B, 489C, 120B, 4201, 121, 123 of Indian Penal Code 1860 and section 16, 17, 18 and 20 of UAPA 1967.
If it please your lordship, may the counsel for the prosecution make a submission.
Yes.
Much obliged, your lordship. The learned counsel for the defense has mentioned things that are not provided in the memo.
In short. What in short?
Much obliged, your lordship.
Yes, just go ahead.
The learned counsel for the defense has mentioned points that are not provided in their memorial, which we are not supposed to do.
Yes.
That's all, your lordship. I just wanted to mention that they have said things there that is not provided in their memorial.
Okay. Memorial, different things. For the discussion or query, other thing. We are asking some question. You should be the fair for that. Being as a defense counsel, we have to never admit the any crime. But you are before the court. When the court clarification came to you, you will have to admit that this fact. Memorial and pleading, that is different part.
Which applies to you.
And court question is other thing.
Thank you.
Being as a defense counsel, being the prosecutor, suppose you are looking for the prosecutor, even you will have to oppose the bail during the course of bailable offense. That is a duty of the prosecutor. If you will say this is a bailable offense, then someone will say that you have taken the money from bribe from some other person. That is a different thing. But memorial different thing, but during the court question, you will have to own us the facts. This is the fact. I have. And defense, anything you want to say? The speaker one?
No, sir.
Okay, best of luck. Best of luck in the future also. And come in practice.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, judges and team members. Now, first team member will leave. And after that, the honorable judges will leave the meeting. We're going to wind up the court now. Team members, you can log out now. Judges will be logging out at the end. Our respected judges, kindly provide the marking performer, may marks, so that we can update it in the very first go. You can do it either WhatsApp or you can mail us also.
Okay, we will mail you within 5 minutes.
Sure, sir.
Yes, I'm also sending.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for
inviting. Thank you, sir. Yeah.
Okay.
Madam, last time you said that I was with you. Last year we said that I was with you in my group. Just I'm recognizing the face.
Me?
Last year?
No, sir.
Someone else, sir.
Okay. Maybe. Ji, nice to meet you.
Thank you.
Namaskar.